Our version of Kong is a lonelier, older character.
That's the thing that was exciting to me about doing this movie was being able to take a character like Kong and say, what happens with time with this character? What happens when the world kind of moves on past him?
It's 30 odd years later. Adam wanted to introduce a bigger, older Kong, someone who is sort of street worn. He's been in a few brawls, I guess, with skull crawlers and other creatures that live on Skull Island.
In Skull Island, you know, he's basically good, the bad, and the ugly Clint Eastwood. And in this film, he's essentially unforgiven Clint Eastwood. So he's sort of the gunfighter without the gunfight. He's a bit bigger and bulkier. And, you know, I think he's probably, you know, has little aches and pains here and there.
Bravo 55, Charlie, take two. What?
Action.
No. We've already wreaked havoc on Kong's habitat. No way am I letting you drag him halfway around the world to use him as a weapon.
Not as a weapon, as an ally.
The locations are absolutely stunning. We shot in Hawaii for 2 months, and we start on Skull Island, which is jungle, obviously.
Hawaii was fantastic. It can be a bit crazy at times because the weather will fluctuate. You never know what the volcano's going to do. Like, we literally scouted the movie and then the volcano started erupting and covered a bunch of the locations we'd fallen in love with lava, which we still haven't been able to go back. So we're at the mercy of the elements.
We're in these mission suits for the big part of the movie, and it's been incredibly hot. Fortunately, a lot of it is on sound stages, so that saved us.
We always wanted the costumes to have a really immediate kind of iconic appeal to it. And we tried to make sure that the costumes were always something that could evolve as the movie goes.
I really wanted the costumes starting on Skull Island to sort of feel very organic to that island, so to speak. Whether it was from the color palette, whether it was the sort of fabric set we were using, Nathan and Dr. Andrews both work on this island, so I wanted their costumes to kind of reflect that. Gia, she's an iwi, she's a child of the island. I sort of wanted her to have more of a contemporary feeling with her clothes, but then the iwi wrap that we did on her is just a wonderful nod to her heritage.
Kong, classically, is always a character who's kind of a romantic type. He always falls in love with the pretty blonde. And in this case, it kind of felt more like what Kong needed wasn't a love interest. He needed sort of a family. And so that's kind of where Gia comes in, is that, you know, Kong's a lonely character, Gia's a lonely character, and they really find each other.
There's a real kinship between Gia and Kong that we begin to discover over the course of the film. They both feel like outsiders.
Because her parents died at an early age, Kong became this kind of almost like savior to her. She loves him, she worships him, he's sort of her best friend, whether he knows it all the time or not.
Gia is also hearing impaired, so she feels especially isolated from that. And she has an incredibly strong bond with Kong.
The fact that Gia is hearing impaired, so she has to communicate with sign language, this is a new evolution of what we can do with Kong, because he's always seen as a very intelligent character, but, you know, he's kind of a backwoods type of guy. I mean, he hasn't gone to school, he has no education, so we've never, in any of these films, you know, you've never been able to explore fully what Kong's intelligence level is, other than he's obviously smarter than the average monkey. Being able to show that he can understand sign language and be able to communicate in that way shows what an interesting, fully rounded character he is.
Loki just talk?
Finding the right girl to play Gia was an incredible challenge. She's a young, hearing-impaired, iwi girl, and we had to look outside of the traditional channels to find her. And Kaylee Hoddle, who we're very fortunate to have cast in the film, had never been in a film before, and Sarah Finn, our casting director, was able to locate her, and the moment we met her, we knew she was the right girl for the part.
Kaylee, who's a newcomer, you know, she's a deaf actress, and she's 10 years old, I think, and she's probably the most professional actor I've ever worked with in a weird way. It's really bizarre. This is her first movie, but she seems to know more than anybody here, which is a huge relief. You know, anytime you're working with kids, you know, there's always this kind of trial and error period, but with her, we never had any of that.
Kaylee is, number one, a really good actor. She hasn't been on a film set. This is the first time she's done anything like this, and she is as instinctive and brilliant as you could be given those circumstances. I mean, she really is very talented, so she's incredibly rewarding to work with as an actor. Like, she gives so much. As I've got to know her better, I've realized that she's extremely funny and playful, and she's just a great kid to be around, and so I feel proud to say we have become friends. Now, a lot of this friendship is predicated on her teaching me ASL, which she frankly knows that I'm fairly bad at, and she tells me off a lot about it. We've also tried to work out magic tricks. There's a lot of sets that have a lot of rubble on them and like little bits of rocks and things like this. And I showed her a trick that my dad used to always do to kids when, you know, you have a thing and then you drop it into your hand and it's gone. And she has expanded on this theme to great effect. She now does a thing with like a half pencil and a thing down her sleeve. I mean, she's off to the races. She's gonna be a magician and an actor and anything she wants to be, frankly.